somewhat being late, the council was getting, and the press were getting a quick tour of the new community building, and it's looking very nice. The town clerk would call the roll, please.
Chairman Roberts.
Present.
Council Berry.
Here.
Council Carson.
Here.
Council Fritz.
Here.
Council Lynch.
Here.
Council McGinty.
Here.
Council Swift Kayata.
Here.
Manager McGovern.
Here.
And town clerk Wayne. Pledge of allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do any of the councilors have any reports or correspondence they'd like to share with us this evening? Councilor Berry.
Well,
eight before.
In our packet, we received a letter saying from Mr. Flavin, saying as a result of the July workshop, it appears the town council's general opinion is to continue to allow students and others to paint their messages and graffiti on the rock. And he goes on to explain that the problem has become worse since it has been brought to our attention. And I think to the extent that anyone is able to paint on the rock, I think Mr. Flavin is able to paint on the rock, and perhaps he could, just a suggestion. He said he won't be able to attend this town meeting. However, he says you may read this letter into the record at that time. My suggestion is that if anybody else can paint messages like happy birthday or goodbye lucky, or that Mr. Flavin can paint too, so perhaps he could enlist some assistance from his pals and paint the rock nice brown and paint over everything that's painted there. So we'll see what happens next.
Thank you.
Just
Councilor Swift Kayata.
Thank you. I just wanted to thank the Betty Crane and the Fort Williams Commission. I attended their annual luncheon along with several other councilors, and it was a very nice affair, and I think they're doing a very good job for Fort Williams, and I just wanted to let them know of our appreciation. Similarly, I attended the Thomas Memorial Library Friends luncheon on August 5th, and I wanted to publicly thank them for all that they do on a regular basis to make the Thomas Memorial Library the jewel that it is. And lastly, I just wanted to mention that Bob Malley, who is CAPE's Public Works Director, is the new chairperson of the Council of Governments Public Works Directors Association, and I just wanted to recognize him for his leadership role in that organization.
Thank you very much. Councilor Fritz.
I just wanted to mention that I had the privilege to be able to present an award to Hannaford Brothers from the as Recycler of the Year from the Regional Waste System, where we take our trash. We make an annual award. And I won't go into the details of how much they recycle, but they do recycle 65% of the waste that is generated in their entire business in the state of Maine. And they're really a leader in the food industry in the country in terms of being responsible about their wastes. And it's nice that they had their beginnings in Cape Elizabeth. So that was quite a privilege to give them that award.
Thank you. Councilor Carson.
I never, of course, comment on this particular time in the council meeting, but I have this little piece of fluff that I feel driven to say to the parents of the 100 junior and high school students who came out to clean up the Goddard Mansion so we could save it from demolition. It now has a gorgeous picture of it in this month's Down East magazine, which was just shown to me. So I hope there's some of those parents out there watching that can tell those kids that the building is saved and now they'll never take it down. We have a picture in Down East about it.
Councilor McGinty.
I'm looking at the Personnel Advisory Committee minutes from the meeting on July 8th. In there it says Family Fun Day fireworks are scheduled for September 6th. Is that...
That was correct as of the date of the minutes of that meeting. They're now scheduled for September 7th. At the time they met, it was scheduled for the 6th.
Okay, I just wanted to verify that.
September 7th is the correct date.
Correct date.
Thank you, John. Mary Ann.
I really don't have anything to add.
All right.
Get on with the meeting.
Very good. I've got a couple of comments. I'd just like to thank the staff and the town manager on down for the excellent job they did in helping the Beach to Beacon people get the race off and running and completed. Although most of those services are reimbursed by the Beach to Beacon folks, the town does put a tremendous effort in making sure that it runs right, and they really did a superlative job again this year. The other thing that I'd like to mention, that there's been some articles in the paper recently about why you probably shouldn't go outdoors, and I would just advise people that, yes, you do need to exercise some caution being out. We do have rabies in all of southern Maine. It's not just Cape Elizabeth. And if you're out walking, you probably ought to be bringing a heavy walking stick or something with you that you could use. Don't forget the fly dope for the ticks and the mosquitoes. And don't forget the sunscreen for the cancer. So go out and enjoy the outside. Don't get too paranoid, but just use some common sense and when you're out there. Set you up for anything on that one, Mike? So I'm all set. The town manager's report.
I don't think I have anything to follow that.
Nothing. All right, very good. Next item on the agenda is the citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. And we do have a number of people in the audience tonight. Is there anyone that would like to address the council on any agenda item, non-agenda item? Okay. Can we have a motion to approve the minutes of the meeting on the last meeting? July 8th.
I move that the minutes for the July 8th meeting be approved.
Second.
And seconded. Any discussion on the minutes? Councilor Berry.
On my agenda, it says minutes of the meeting 2-2-0-3. I don't understand that.
It's the second meeting of the year 2002-2003.
Oh, thank you very much.
I think I made that mistake last week, or last month, too. Any other comments or discussion? All in favor of accepting the minutes? Anyone opposed? Councilor Berry, you in favor, or? So it could be unanimous. Gather my notes up here. Got too many of them. Item number 23-02-03, proposed vacation of a portion of Bayview Road. I would ask the town manager if he could give us just a brief update of what's happening there.
Yeah, Bayview Road is actually the remnants of a paper street that actually is between Highview Road and up around Trundy Road, between Shore Acres and the Eastfield neighborhood. It was abandoned by the town council in two sections back in the 1990s. There's one additional small sliver that was not abandoned that sort of rests between the Canaley property on Highview Road and the Panansky property up on the back of Trundy Road, actually on Overlook Lane, which is a private road up that way. The Panansky's have asked the town to consider abandoning the paper street, which referred to the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission. The Conservation Commission looked at it and said that was fine with them. It didn't hold any greenbelt potential. The Planning Board said it would be fine to abandon it. However, there should be a reservation that it in no way allow additional setbacks to be gained as a result of the abandonment, setback benefits that the old setbacks should stand. The water district also, this was sent to, and they responded that they have a seasonal water line that goes into this area as well, and that right ought to be retained. Anyway, we asked the town attorney to look at it, and we received at 5 o'clock this afternoon a draft order for the council that does a number of things. It takes into account the Planning Board recommendation, and it takes into account the reservation for the water district. We did have the attorneys look at the issue of whether or not you could restrict the setback issue as the Planning Board was proposing. Mike Hill looked at that, one of our town attorneys, and it was his finding that there is no case law on point, that, you know, there's no examples of it having any case law at all, either way, put it simply. But anyway, I think it's particularly noteworthy, and I'll read it because in this particular instance, you haven't had time to read it because you just got it on the counter. But number three is, this vacation order is subject to the condition that any new construction on the property now will formally owned by Thomas Benancy and described in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds, etc., and the property now will formally owned by John P. Keneally and Rose M. Keneally and described in a deed recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds, etc., shall comply with the setback requirements of the property lines as described in said deeds and not from the new property lines as a result of this vacation order. This would, you know, is something that would affect both the Keneally property and the Panansky property. As of about 5 o'clock, this was shared with the attorney for the Panansky's, who's here today, and it was also shared with the Keneally's, and Mr. Keneally's here today.
Thank you very much. It is not a public hearing, but I realize there are a couple of people that might like to speak to this item. If you'd like to step forward, give your name and address, we will hear brief comments on the subject, if anyone is interested.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Jack Keneally. I live at 16 Highview Road with my wife, and we are on one side of the paper street in question. Property on the other side of the street is owned by Mr. Panansky, who's an absentee owner. Lives in Asia, actually. When Mr. Panansky's attorney first contacted me about Mr. Panansky's interest in vacating the street, I asked him what the reason for it was, and he said, no reason in particular, he just wanted the extra land. My wife and I talked about it, thought about it, you know, what would be the worst case scenario, the way it might affect us. And that way that would affect us would be if that property were to be redeveloped, essentially, and someone might tear down the houses there. This happens all over Cape right now. Put up a larger house that's 25 feet closer to us than anything could be right now. The problem with that, if you haven't been to the property, we live on a hillside, and the Panansky property is at the top of the hill right above us. And my fear would be that we could have some hulking mansion up there, basically looking into our bedrooms, which are on the second floor of our house, and also shielding us from the winter sun, which is when winter days are short, we need the sun from outside. So we were not at all in favor of that. And I conveyed that to both Mr. Thielen, who was Mr. Panansky's attorney, and also by email to the planning board for their workshop. I could not be at their workshop because I was out of town at that time. And I suggested to Mr. Thielen, Mr. Panansky's attorney, that he execute a private deed restriction which would place the same restriction on the property that now is being proposed by the town to protect our interest. And he didn't give me a direct answer to that, and I guess what he ended up doing was working with the planning board to come up with this restriction here. My concern with the way this is worded right now is based on the following. After I found out that the planning board recommended, I was talking about it with my daughter, who's an attorney out of state, and she said, Dad, that sounds to me like what's called de facto spot zoning, which had most states don't look kindly on spot zoning, where you basically, in some de facto way, put restrictions or conditions on one piece of land that differs from other pieces of land in the same neighborhood. So I'm not really in a position to spend a lot of resources on attorneys, so I tried to research this myself, and the internet is a great resource, as some of you may know. And unfortunately, I couldn't find anything on the state side of things, but I did find a number of references among municipalities in Maine, references to spot zoning, and all of these references to spot zoning, either implicitly or more explicitly, made reference to the fact that the state did not condone spot zoning. I made copies of one article, which I'll pass out to the council. Mark, paragraph on page 2.
quotes from the Supreme Court at the moment.
Jack, I can pass them along.
So my concern remains that if this vacation order was passed by the town council, it's not clear to me that the town council has the authority to execute a spot zoning restriction, and so I don't believe that we would have the protection that we seek. And so I would much prefer to see Mr. Finansky and his attorney, Mr. Thielen, execute a private restriction on the property, which I believe would have more force of law than this one. I've talked to Mr. Finansky several times about this. He was here, back here in the U.S. a few weeks ago. He was courteous enough to stop by my house and introduce himself. And I asked him the question, do you plan to move back here? He said, no, I don't think so. I'm pretty much living in Asia now. And so it's an investment property for him. And maybe that doesn't matter too much, but it matters to us because it's our home. And I don't believe that if the time were not to vacate the current paper street, I don't believe the use of Mr. Finansky's property or his intended use would be compromised at all. My concern is what would happen with a use that's not perhaps intended right now by Mr. Finansky, by a future owner, where some kind of very large house could be put up there. And that's not a remote possibility. I should have mentioned earlier, if you go up to that property, there's a very expansive view of the ocean and Portland Headlight from the top of that hillside. The advantage in moving to the back of the property with a future house would be that you get the view more expansive. So that's really why we feel threatened by that possibility. And Mr. Finansky's told us he has no intention of doing anything like that, but circumstances can change people's intention, and the sale of property can change all of that too. So summing that up, you know, my concern is that the paragraph number 3 in the proposed vacation order, I don't believe that, from what I can find out, that might not carry any weight with the state. It might be very easily overturned by an appeal by either Mr. Finansky or a future owner of that property. So I would ask that the town delay vacation of the property, and I'd like to talk to Mr. Finansky and Mr. Thielen about a private deed restriction which executes the same exact restriction that would carry more force of law than this rule.
Thank you very much. Does anybody have any questions of Mr. Keneally? No? Anyone else who'd like to? Henry?
Oh, well, I just had a question because I wasn't clear on this map exactly the area that was being proposed to be vacated. I didn't know if it was from the corner of...
It's a strip of land that's...
So from entirely across the back of your property?
Yes. Pretty much. I think it's the entire back, yeah.
The area that shows. I don't think Mr. Keneally is the expert to point out the area. With all due deference to my...
You're absolutely correct.
To my neighbor. Mr. Thielen's also here, Mr. Chairman. I'll go.
Right.
Excuse me, Mike, just for clarification, is it the portion that has got the words Bayview Road on top of it?
Yes, Mr. Thielen's here.
Okay,
the
thanks.
He's got a good man.
We have a portion of what is the Fuller Survey that passes around and put it up on the board there.
What's confusing, I think, to the council, Mr. Thielen, is where the man on the left side.
Where
it hits Katahdin Road extension.
Well, that's a very good question because it's not clear. Bear in mind, this is all derived from a very old subdivision plan, 1912. At that time, they were not particular necessarily.
We should probably have you introduce yourself too before we get too far into the discussion.
Okay. I'm Paul Thielen, and I am representing Mr. Finansky.
At the mic, if you would, so the camera can get you.
Would this work up here? Or?
Yeah.
I talked with Mike Hill about that very point today, as a matter of fact.
because it isn't altogether clear where the limits of Katahdin Road end and Bayview Road begin. But I think the presumption that both he and I came to is that you would take the logical extension of Keneally's western bound and simply draw that down to that point, and that seemed to be the best estimate that one can give of where it is. But I think you will notice that the order, the description in the order, carefully states it to run to and uses Katahdin Road as extension. It doesn't purport to define it, because I don't think that's your role, or I don't think it's our role in this context to try to do that. But we say, whatever that line may be, from here to where it has been vacated previously. This is Bayview Road that has previously been vacated. There's also Bayview Road over on this side that has been previously vacated. So this is all that remains right now, unvacated. And when Mike and I tried to describe for the order, the best that we could come up with is saying, well, let's just take the logical extension of that bound.
Mike, meaning Mike Hill.
Could I ask you a question, please, sir? On your map, where it says Katahdin Road Extension, what is actually there? Is there road there? So that's a paper road, too. Katahdin, where it says Katahdin Road Extension, is a paper road. Thanks.
Councilor Carson.
Yes, I actually happen to live on that, so, and this is, I've been around the council a long time. This is not the first time that this paper road, this section of paper roads has come up. But I'm not questioning why Mr. Pernansky wants that little small section in the back of his house vacated, when actually in the front of his house there's a very serious paper road that practically brushes up against his front porch. Mm. So I can't quite figure out why he wouldn't be more concerned with the front. If somebody were to extend the front, they'd go right through, practically through his kitchen. So the back road is just a nothing piece of road in the woods. So what would be his interest in the back and not in the front?
The interest, as far as I know it to be, stated to me by Mr. Pernansky, is that it increases his lot size to approximately an acre. And from his standpoint, that's desirable. He has no building plans as such. And frankly, this has never come up in our discussions. When he contacted me, it was always with respect to this. Well, I'm sorry, I can't shed any light on that.
No, I just wondered if it had come up, because it certainly is more serious from the front side of the house than
sure.
The back.
Yeah.
Councilor McGinty.
I'm on the history of this. We vacated on both sides of this portion. Why didn't we vacate this portion previously? Did we have any history on that? Do we know why?
I have spoken with Mr. Kelly, who was involved in the previous vacation on that road, because I asked that same question. And apparently, at the time that the vacation of this portion of Bayview Road came up, people that own this house expressed no interest in joining in that request. And so when the order got drafted, it excluded that portion.
For purposes of the record, this is Mr. Jim Kelly, because there's also some Cole Kellys and Paul Kellys who have owned property in that area.
As a response to Councilor McGinty's interest, my recollection, which is probably quite biased, is that we wanted to continue this. The vacating of the first section of that road enhanced Mr. Kelly's property, which he then sold. And I never could figure out why we couldn't go beyond that. I mean, I argued with the manager about it at the time. I remember that I thought it was ridiculous to stop the vacation at that point. So I never could figure out why that one section was left. It enhanced Mr. Kelly's property, but it didn't do anything to anybody else's at the time.
I just wanted to respond, if I may, briefly to a point that Mr. Keneally brought up. It is true that we have had some discussions with Mr. Keneally early on about his concerns and the notion that an agreement ought to be reached, or could be reached, by which neither party would seek to
utilize whatever addition to their property that they were to gain by this vacation to somehow enlarge the building envelope. And I have, in fact, sent a letter, a proposed letter, in a private agreement in that regard. I have advised my client, being an old real estate lawyer that I am, that to be hesitant about putting on record restrictions, and that may come back to bite future generations. And so that hesitancy has come from me, but the intent by Mr. Pinanski is very clear that he's comfortable with the notion of not utilizing that additional area for any building purposes, because he has no plans to do so. I will also, however, then share Mr. Keneally's concern that I'm not quite sure that the order is necessarily, that it's a proper for the for this municipality's order to restrict in that fashion. But we are not opposing it. We wish to have the vacation, so we will agree with the order as drafted.
Councilor Carson.
Yes, in listening to your comments, when you just mentioned about that it sort of goes against your grain as a real estate lawyer to have these restrictions. So the restrictions that you're talking about are the restrictions that Mr. Keneally said, which is to ask for deed restrictions. Are those the ones you feel that you don't philosophically agree with? There are, I mean, many people have deed restrictions in their houses, and they go with the sale of the house. So,
sure. No. But adding, certainly we have to deal with them because they are there, but adding one in this instance didn't seem to be warranted, in my opinion. As a matter of fact, however, if the order goes through in the fashion that it does, that same result will obtain. There will be a restriction on the record.
Could I also ask, since this, of course, was a parcel that was considerably larger than what you're going for now, but it was previous sales, et cetera. I haven't got a calculator here, but if you measure that out as the lines are drawn here, and you add the 25 feet, some of the 25 feet that's going to come with that piece of property, does that make an acre, or are we still short an acre? Or?
According to my client's calculations, he thinks it's
over
an acre. I think you have to bear in mind that he owns these three parcels.
Which three?
I'm sorry. I don't know if you can see this. 109, 132, and 133, okay. Which cumulatively, according to the survey plan, puts him around 42,000 square feet. So.
Right. So I was trying to figure out what the extra 25 feet were going to really do for him on that one parcel.
Because 25 by over 100 plus would mean that he's over 44,000 square feet total.
So you mean lot number 132 and lot number 133 together must equal the acre. But is he trying to keep lot 133 as a separate buildable lot some other time?
Lot 133, 132, and 109 together total, about 41,000.
I can't.
Is that right?
Can I follow up on...
No.
Can I follow up on Councilor Carson's question?
Go ahead.
Would the vacation permit lot 133 to be a separate buildable lot from lot 132?
I don't know. And that's not the intent, I know, Mr. Pinanski, but I honestly don't know.
Well, can I ask a question of the town manager?
Sure.
I understand the question, but I've made a rule over the last couple of decades not to interpret the zoning ordinance.
Going to ask you to interpret the zoning ordinance. I guess my concern as a town councilor is viewing ourselves almost as trustees for the town and the town's property. I always want to ask, what is the benefit to the town for this transaction? And so I guess I would just ask, what would be the benefit for the town? Would we increase the property tax values? Are we creating an additional buildable lot? Why would the town do this, aside from the fact that it's been done in the past?
Let me explain generally why the town does this. And I do want to disclose, I hinted at it when Mr. Keneally was up, I live about two lots away from this property, and I want everyone to understand that, just off the map there. The town generally abandons paper streets for a couple of reasons. Usually it's just as a neighborly action to help out a resident or property owner of the community. If the town has no reason for keeping it, if there doesn't seem to be any objection, you know, in this case there were notices sent out to all of Shore Acres on this particular issue. It's generally done neighborly. The benefit is that there is a little bit more land to tax, but you know, in the big scheme of things, it doesn't change the value of a lot that much from the assessor's viewpoint. They look more at frontage, they look at sales and some of those issues, and I can't say that it changes that much. The detriment to the town is that, you know, it's privately owned, and you know, in this case, if there's a water line in it, you know, it complicates issues when, you know, you do have to replace a line, even though, you know, the rights are there to operate, to maintain, to reserve, you know, in this draft order, that becomes an issue. That's, you know, the highlights of it. Oh, and that's why we refer to the Planning Board and to the Conservation Commission, make sure there aren't trail issues, that there aren't some other issues, and neither of those parties in this instance had any concerns other than the condition that is before you this evening, paragraph 3.
Councilor Carson.
I just wanted to just point out to the council as more information about this. If you look at the paper road that goes across the front, when you see Overlook, just keep looking to the left. It connects with the Katahdin Road, paper road. And then in the middle of the paper going through lot 109, you'll see a dotted line, which is a paved driveway. When the lot 132 bought 109, it provided itself actually the only private driveway that goes up to get to lot 132. Lot 110 has no driveway at all. It leases, gets an easement over the driveway, although they can use a long road. So I'm only thinking about the fact that 133 is a separate lot. It's virtually a landlocked lot. Unless you use that one driveway and cross over the unvacated road across the front of the Panansky house, you then have an entrance to lot 103 to become a separate building lot. Which is sort of why I asked, if you're vacating the back, why wouldn't you want to vacate the front and add some square footage there to get to your 42,000 square feet or 1 acre lot? I mean, I don't care. It doesn't interfere with me at all. It's just that there is a driveway there that's owned by lot 132 now, which is the only access then that could be go to 133, which so it becomes a building lot. I mean, if you want a building lot, that's fine. It's there. I mean, it just shows you how you can get there. I think it's not quite as simple, maybe, as it appears to be.
Mr. Thalen, I have a question for you, too. And when I was reading this, I assumed we were talking lot 132. I, from nothing I read here, indicated that we had three lots. Why wasn't Mr. Polanski's name placed on all three lots that would be clear to us?
I'm sorry, I don't know what you're referring to.
On your map, you have 109, 132, and 133, but there's nothing to identify who. All the other lots are identified who the owners are, but neither one of these showed who those were owned.
That's not a survey plan that was even. This was a survey plan that was obtained from the person that sold the property to Mr. Panansky. It was done at the time pursuant to that sale. There wasn't any. So at the time that this was done, Christina Goldfein was the owner of this property. I just used this survey plan because I thought it very helpful to the council, depicting the area and the lots involved. I'm not sure I'm answering your question, but Mr. Panansky now owns what's denoted here as Goldfein.
Any other questions of Mr. Thalen?
I might, if I may, just also add a point about the process of vacation does not necessarily end here. The town orders a vacation of the street. The order then gets recorded in the registry of deeds, and there's a period of time after that, during which private parties or anybody else who may have a claim or feels they have a claim to this parcel can come forward and do so. They must do so within that time period if they don't. What the town is vacating is the incipient right to accept that as a street eventually. And it seems to me that if there is never any opportunity or possibility of that being the case, which I urge is the case here, given the vacations that have taken place already, the town is not really... What is the interest of the town? I guess it's measured against that.
Councilor Swift-Kiata.
I want to clarify something that you might have heard Mr. Thielen, you might have inferred from what he said, and I'm not sure he's correct. He was pointing out that there's a year's worth of appeal and of parties of interest. Generally, in paper street issues, parties of interest tend to be the individuals within the same subdivision who all have certain rights to all of the paper streets in their subdivision. This particular lot is part of the Shore Acres subdivision. So everyone in Shore Acres could make such a claim. Mr. Keneally's claim might, and correct me if you think I'm wrong, would not have as much standing as someone lives in Shore Acres because his home is not part of the Shore Acres subdivision. So he doesn't have the ownership rights to the extent that someone in the Shore Acres subdivision would have.
Mike, I guess I would take issue with that. Being an abutting owner, you would.
That's fine. Councilor Swift,
for the record.
I think that's a matter for perhaps further discussion and perhaps even a court to decide someday, but whatever. We were talking about what the interests of the town are, and I'm reflecting on what Councilor Lynch said as to why should we do this. And the manager mentioned that one reason that the town would be interested in vacating this would be to be good neighbors. You know, the town had no use for it, and basically just to help out neighbors, fellow citizens in Cape Elizabeth. And that would hold a lot of weight with me if both the parties involved both wanted the same thing. Then we'd be helping them both, but this seems to be a situation where it would be helping Mr. Pinanski. I don't know if eventually he would want to build on the lot, and perhaps he would change his mind from what he told you, or he might sell the lot someday and somebody else might do it. But in the meantime, he'd be gaining some sort of benefit, but the Keneally's obviously feel that they would not be gaining. In fact, they would feel they would be bearing some sort of risk or... losing something in this situation. So for that reason, I think if we're interested in helping neighbors, I can't see why we would be interested in wanting to help one and hurt another.
I listened to what Mr. Mead, I don't understand the point of why Mr. Keneally would be hurt necessarily, but I would also just emphasize that the order that's in front of you, as I understand it, puts in and addresses the concern Mr. Keneally had about Mr. Pinanski somehow increasing or utilizing this to increase...
But wouldn't a deed restriction do the same thing?
Councilor Swift-Kiata, I think Mr. Thielen wasn't even recognized a minute ago. I think the council really at some point needs to just discuss this amongst ourselves and
close
it up. Well,
if I could make a further comment. If I could make a further comment, then.
Okay.
Not directed at our attorney here. Or not our attorney, the Pinanski's attorney, excuse me. I think that it was said that the Keneally's objection was not understood, and I think I have a fair understanding of what their objection is that they're afraid that somebody could build a bigger house closer to their property that might shade their property or might be looking into their windows because of the topographic nature of the lot. And if indeed Mr. Pinanski is not interested in building and really has no intention of ever building, then I don't understand why he would object to having a deed restriction, which would satisfy the Keneally's. But that's not for us to decide. That's between the two of them to figure out, I guess. But I will not be supporting the vacation.
Any other councilors wish to address the item? Councilor McGinty.
I agree 100% with Councilor Kiata. I thought they were closer than this. I thought the Keneally's and Pinanski's, so their attorney, had come together. I guess they're still a little bit apart. I'm wondering if we might table this to see if they can get back together and solve that situation, as I agree with Ann about protecting, if that's the right term, protecting the property interests of the Keneally's at least. So I'd like to see if maybe we can...
Mr. Chairman, can I ask a question, though?
One more.
Pardon me?
Yes, one.
Through the chair. The two concerns that have just been expressed about protection are exactly in that order. They're there. And Mr. Pinanski, we are agreeable with that. And Mr. Pinanski, he cannot do any more than he can now by acquiring that property. It's there in that order. So I guess I just commend that to the council.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
May I make a comment? I would support either tabling it or, at this point, I would oppose it if we don't table it. The question I have is, and I understand that the Pinanskis are willing to accept the order as drafted, and I appreciate that. I guess the concern I have, though, is to the extent that a subsequent owner of that property might challenge this as spot zoning, it doesn't give the Keneally's much security. So I guess the question I would like to have directed to our own town council, if we are to table it and hopefully have an answer at the next meeting, would be, could we have a condition in this order that says, in the event that it is subsequently determined that this is spot zoning, that the vacated way would revert to the town? And so that would be a question I would have. The second question I feel I need an answer to is, what will become of lot 133? Is that already a separate buildable lot? And if so, that's fine. But if not, is this something that is creating a lot that doesn't exist, that's buildable, or giving access to a lot that's currently landlocked? And that may be a good thing. I'm not opposed to having another buildable lot, but I think we as a council need to have that information before us before we go forward with this.
Councilor Fritz.
I guess I'm thinking that instead of asking our attorney this question, to actually have the parties agree before we vacate it. But I'm also concerned about the water main and whether there's what area it supplies, and if there's already an easement there in that, or is that something that would have to be created if this became a divided parcel.
Manager?
I can answer the water main question. The water district is currently taking advantage of the paper street, and as part of the paper street vacation order, the easement would in essence be granted as part of that order, the reservation.
Councilor Berry.
On that subject, the water line, it says a 2-inch line. That's a summer line, isn't it? Mm-hmm. In the future, might they want to enlarge that? I mean, we don't want to foreclose that possibility. And also the sewer question. A lot of unanswered questions. I move the table.
Move the table. Second. the no discussion on the table, correct? All in favor of tabling? All opposed? I believe it's 6-1.
Are we tabling to a date? Are we tabling to a workshop? Are we tabling to discussion? Are we tabling for the two parties to agree and come to us? What are we tabling? Just out of point of information.
The motion, the staff considers the motion to table.
As denial.
Being that it would not come back to the council unless it was reconsidered at the next meeting.
Hmm. And someone on the prevailing side would have to bring the motion forward.
Right.
I'm
time we're finished with this item.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? I didn't hear you.
Someone on the prevailing side would need to bring it forward at the next meeting if we so desired.
Well, you know, I think the intent was clear that the Keneally's and Mr. Phelan need to get together and bring up something that we can support.
But it wasn't in the motion, but I think you're right. The discussion would indicate that.
That's the intent.
Well, I can speak only for myself, but I would be interested in seeing.
I would suggest.
Come to us with a mutually acceptable agreement.
And then let one of us, or myself, know, or the town manager know that you have come to some kind of agreement and ask me that whether we would be willing to put it back on the agenda.
Could I ask one more follow-up question? Says somebody, either our attorney, Mike Hill, I'm interested in the deed restriction comments that were made before. Is this a possibility to deal with? True Acres has lots of feet of paper roads, and is the deed restriction a way to deal with this? I don't know. He got a comment, but I'd like to know about it.
Could I suggest something to the council?
Absolutely.
Yeah. The way you've tabled this, you know, I know. You know, one of the issues is you have to provide notice for one of these actions. And someone looking at this could challenge it and say that it was tabled, that it's dead, and that to revive it, you need to renotice it. You know, I would suggest that if it's your intent, as you've indicated, that maybe you reconsider the motion and simply table it to the next meeting, awaiting a report of those issues that you've raised, so that it's clearly still on the table. Notices don't need to go out again to all the various parties, and that you know the parties have a chance to do those things that you suggest.
For procedural reason, I will move to
procedurally. How do we get there? I guess is the question. Procedurally, how do we get there with the repeal?
You vote to reconsider, and then you.
Henry just made a suggestion.
I move to reconsider the table.
Is there a second? There is a second. All in favor.
Reconsider. I now move to table the matter for the next meeting.
Second.
Any further discussion on the motion?
You can't. I'm sorry.
Is that what we need?
Debate whether or not that's the appropriate time for a motion to table.
Point of information? You can do point of information, right? Point of information, Mr. Chairman?
Please.
Question? So was that tabling motion? I wasn't sure I understood that tabling motion. Did by that tabling motion, did you mean table it till next month?
Yes.
That's right.
And basing it upon getting a report from the two parties?
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure I understood that.
All right. And we had looked into these other issues that other councils have raised.
Okay.
All right. Very good. Is everyone clear? Can we move on? Councilor?
Could I just say one thing? I see the audience out there. We're sort of stymied here because in parliamentary procedure, when somebody tables something, there's no discussion. So we're all got words ready to pop out of our mouths, but we're not allowed to discuss anything because it's inappropriate to do that. So that's why we're all sort of stumbling around. Once it's tabled, you just vote, and then you don't get to talk about it anymore. So let's just want to explain that.
Well, moving on to the second.
We didn't vote on the table.
We didn't vote on
that. Moved and seconded.
Right. I had to say all in favor. I guess I got cut off, didn't I?
All in favor
of the motion. Anyone opposed? Show it unanimous. Now we can move on to the second item of the evening. Item number 24-02-03, request for consent agreement regarding a setback violation at 10 Pout Place. And I would ask the town manager to again update us on this one.
This is a much easier issue than the first one.
It certainly is.
What this involves is a house that was built back in 1998.
In this road.
True an error. It was supposed to have a 30-foot setback. For whatever reason, it has slightly less than that. It's 28.6 feet from the property line. The zoning board, I think, really did a good job with this when they met on July 23rd. I know councilors have raised at times concern that they're granting variances, perhaps when they shouldn't be granting variances. And the zoning board heard that and felt, as the letter from David Jones, the attorney, indicates this is a much more common sense approach to deal with this issue. And that is essentially what you have before you this evening, which is a proposed complaint that we would file in district court against the owners of the property and that would be immediately followed in the same, you know, in the very next filing with a consent decree and a court order that would agree to it. It would all be a quick resolution and, you know, really no problem. You know, there were no concerns addressed by any of the neighbors at the zoning board level after all the notices were given. You have a letter from the Hutmans who are very concerned. They have a contract to sell the property, want to deal with. I notice there's a plethora of real estate agents in the audience who are intimately involved in this issue. But and it's all been reviewed by a town attorney, and he thinks this is a wonderful solution. And I think it would save us some potential litigation. It saves the property owner a big hassle of trying to figure out how to tear down the foot and a half section. And I would encourage you to consider this. And also, there is a blank space there that there's be a civil penalty, attorney's fees and costs. It's recommended that the insert there be $1,000. And that is intended to be a message that, you know, these things aren't taken lightly, and that there ought to be some civil penalty. It's not a very large amount, but at the same time, it does send a message that contractors and others should be more careful in the future.
Check them up, the real estate.
Councilor Carson.
I move approval of the consent agreement as stated, as set forth. I can't find my paper right now to read any more than that. Can I just move approval of the consent agreement? Is that enough?
The complaint and the consent agreement.
The complaint and the consent agreement.
Second.
And we have a second. Any discussion?
I just have a question, just to be clear, that the attorney's fees, does that include all the attorney's fees that we may, as a town, have incurred in this?
My sense is it includes the attorney's fees following the zoning board action. It would not include any attorney's fees as part of the zoning board consideration. Only the council action itself. There might be I doubt there's maybe an hour's worth of time. Mr. Jones would know better than I would, but I don't think they have much time in it.
I also had a question that perhaps somebody in the audience can answer. And I drove out by the property yesterday up into the driveway, and there's a huge granite or ledge outcrop. And I thought to myself, why didn't they just buy a foot and a half on the other property and give the neighbor the $1,000 rather than paying all these fines and stuff? But perhaps you could answer that question.
Well, that is an option, but it's an approved subdivision, and to move lot lines would require going back to the planning board and asking for an amended subdivision plan.
You just answered my question. Time. Okay. Thank you.
This is David Jones of Jensen Peacock.
I might just point out that the motion did not include filling in the blank as recommended by the manager, and that should be part of your vote so that the town attorney knows exactly what you want.
All right. Thank you.
Town clerk can reflect that in my motion.
Any further discussion?
Well, I don't think the manager mentioned that the abutting property owners had a letter in favor and not objecting to it, which I think is important. But I don't think this should happen on a routine kind of basis. I think we should be out there measuring while these things are being built so that we don't have this continually happening. And it isn't a continuous thing, but...
Thank you. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion? Show it unanimous. Item number 25-02-03, request to amend the sewer service area map to include acreage on Route 77 across from Ramble Road. Mr. Manager, would you please?
Yes, Peter Anastos, who is the prospective property owner, is at the microphone, and I think you have a memo. There's actually two items. One is the specific request, and one is a large request. And I would like to confirm that I did speak to Bruce Smith about this, who confirms that the septic system is in need of repairs on the primary lot in question.
Thank you very much. Mr. Anastos, would you like to make some additional comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Council. My name is Peter Anastos. I'm buying 246 Ocean House Road. As I sat there, I just had a flash. I forgot how many acres. I think it's 7.5 acres. It might be 8.5, but it's almost irrelevant as I explained. In any case, it's an old house with a failed septic system.
Which one is 246? We have in red Fisher and Hewitt.
and Aceto.
It's Fisher.
And Aceto? It's the Fisher House. Okay.
Fisher House. And the sewer is directly across the street from the house at Ramble Road, I believe. And I would propose to bring the sewer at my expense across the street to service the house. When I called Bob Malley of Public Works to find out how to do this sort of thing, he told me about the procedure of coming to the council and how to do it. And he said that if there's extra land there, you should look into any future possibilities there. So before I did that, I had Dick Sweet from Sweet Associates come out and do septic tests and also check for the wetlands. I could put a couple of septic systems in there and then fix the one that's on the house that has failed. But there's a type 1 wetland, which is down off my property. I could show you on that plan. But it's off my property, so there's a 250-foot setback from that property. I feel that these, even having these septic systems, would cramp the house. It's not my intention to build two more houses, but I wouldn't kid you, I am a builder. I mean, that's what I've done. Even though I'm out of that part of the business now, my name's still on the letterhead. And I don't want to give up that right to the land, so to speak, or the right to bring it forth to the planning board. Bob suggested that I bring it across and then have service to the house with a T, so to speak, so that it could service two more lots or whatever, whoever I was looking for, if in the future, possibly. It's my intention to buy this house, fix it up, restore it. The reason I bought it, frankly, is it's just a beautiful old brick house, slate roof, barn, lovely grounds. That's all I'm doing is painting it, sanding the floors, and putting it back on the market, frankly. I used to do, that's how I started. It's almost nostalgic reasons I'm doing it. I have no idea, actually, in some ways, I have no idea why I'm doing it, but I like it, so that's why I'm doing it. Benefits for the town, Councilor Lynch, I'm glad I sat through that last one. At first I wasn't, then I was. But benefit to the town certainly is revenue enhancement for the sewer district, certainly for the house, and if any others came online. But more importantly, of course, environmentally, septic, when you have a sewer right in front of the house, to have a septic system doesn't seem right anyway in this day and age. Bob also said the reason I'm bringing it before I own it is that the state is possibly going to do some shim work, and next year they may repave the road, and he suggested I get in as soon as possible. All contingencies have passed. I am buying it. I'll own it probably September 17th. I think that pretty much covers it.
Thank you very much. Councilor Barry.
Thank you. Mr. Anastas, how soon would the sewer be installed completely?
If I own it September 17th, I literally...
This fall?
Yeah, I'd do it right away because that's what Bob wanted me to do.
The reason I ask is that we are, as I understand, going to do that section. The state is going to do Route 77 there, so I'd like to get you in if we vote to do that before they put the road on top of it, so we don't have to dig it up again.
That's why I'm here early.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You like that thinking?
Any further discussions? Councilor Fritz.
What is the size of that lot?
Of the Fisher property?
Right.
Oh, I could get it. I believe it's 7.5 acres. It's a minimum 7.5 acres. It could be 8.5. I mean, so as far as a square footage basis, I mean, it could handle far more than three lots. But with all the setback requirements from wetlands and such, it wouldn't be realistic to say nothing of the fact that the house, if you crowded it in, that's why I don't want to do it. I mean, I haven't developed anything in years, frankly, except little things. In fact, I did something on Shore Road a number of years ago, three lots. And that could have had far more lots as well, as you may know. But it's sort of an estate setting. I think that's the way it should stay. That being said, I didn't want to put the deed restriction or anything like that, and I think the most that could go over there realistically is three lots.
Any further discussion? I would just comment myself that I agree with you that I don't think we should put septic tanks into the ground and when we have sewers handy, so I'll be voting in favor of this. Councilor Lynch, did you have something?
I was going to echo the same thing. I see this perhaps as a move towards a saner sewer policy in this town. So I would support the request.
Can you say it fast?
Saner sewer.
Saner sewer.
Somebody want to move the question?
Well, I'd just like to point out that this really is in Residence A, not in Residence B, as across the area across the street, which is sewered. And according to our Residence A, this is land in which public sewer lines are not expected to be extended.
But they're not prohibited, right?
They're not prohibited, no, but extending them in order to provide for more development of the land, I don't think is the intention of our comprehensive plan.
But wouldn't
it seems to me that on a 7.5-acre parcel, one could find an adequate spot for a septic system to repair that. I think that the potential to, if you have the sewer on that side of the street to that area that is not really densely developed and is in near a wetland area, you could use the sewer to make smaller lots, because a sewer would imply that you could have smaller lots and you would not be polluting the wetlands. So I think we could end up with an area that would have much more dense development. And I think that there are some lots behind that could be served then from this once that sewer were extended.
That's true.
So I think it's a really bad idea that shouldn't certainly be decided to extend for this particular party now without really considering, and I mean the next item on the agenda is to talk about that a little bit more, but I don't think we should do this and then talk about the policy. We should really consider the policy because it's very much against the comprehensive plan.
Councilor Swift-Kiata.
Isn't this a situation where, in terms of dealing with the development issue, this property could be developed anyways? Now, the number of houses is perhaps different, but I'm somewhat familiar with Mr. Anastas's previous work, and I don't see him as someone who would be perhaps putting up lots and lots of little houses. I think that this is a situation that is allowed for when there is a failing sewer system on one of the lots, so it is a situation where you could go in and deal with that, and I think it would be prudent on our part, especially since we don't want to have 77 dug up again, that, you know, I agree, in general, it's always best to look at the broad policy first, and then get down to the more tactical level, detailed level, but in this particular situation, I think it's allowed because there's sort of an emergency kind of situation, and I also think it would be good for it would be worth it for all the citizens of Cape not to have to go over a big bump in the road if the sewer suddenly got put in. You know, I've heard many complaints about Route 77 being extremely bumpy, and to me it seems that this would be the sort of situation that we could deal with. And it's my understanding, I think from the background reading on the next item, that the sewer system is currently at about 50% capacity. So I'm not really worried about capacity issues at this point. So those are just my comments.
All right, Councilor Carson.
Well, this is an interesting thing because I'm certainly in favor of sewers because I don't consider them to be the right tool to control growth. Councilor Fricks and I have been through this over 15 years, I guess, maybe more on this. But I am concerned about her comments that to agree to this now before we even have the discussion on the policy issues surrounding this exact same thing seems to be putting the cart before the horse. On the other hand, I think that the three existing houses should have the right to hitch up to the sewer, which is right there. But it seems to me that exactly what you're saying, what we're doing is permitting the construction, the potential opening of those other lots before we've even discussed the policy surrounding it. And it seems as a policy-making body, as much as I am pro-sewers, as a policy-making body, it doesn't seem right that we would agree to this before we even get into the discussion of it. And yet I can agree to the existing homes because we have done that before, as existing homes that are already there. So I'm a little reluctant to agree to the entire thing before we have a discussion.
Councilor Lynch?
I would be concerned that we would be penalizing Mr. Anastos. He made this request.
Mm-hmm.
And correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. McGovern, but it seems to me that after the request was made, the town manager thought it was a good idea to relook at the sewer policy. So I would be reluctant to penalize someone who's come forward with a request that makes sense. There's a failing septic system.
I agree to that.
I agree with you. We should not be using sewers and sewer connection policies as a growth control mechanism. There are better ways to control growth than sending people in the direction of putting septic systems in. It makes no sense, in my view, environmentally, to have people put septic systems in when a sewer at 50% of capacity runs right by their house. I think that's a topsy-turvy environmental result. So I don't want to penalize Mr. Anastos for bringing this forward. It's a responsible request on his part. And I likewise think it's responsible of the town manager to say, let's take a look at it. But I don't think we should put his request aside while
either.
We're looking at it.
I don't
need...
I'd just like to point out, though, the reference in the sewer extensions to when you're talking about a replacement system and providing sewage for that, or service for that in the sewer line. It says, where the existing private subsurface system is malfunctioning and a replacement system variance from the State of Maine Department of Human Services would be required for a replacement system. I don't think that's talking about a place where you have a very small lot, you have constraints on where you can place the system. This is 7.5 acres where a conventional system could be located. So in order to follow the existing sewer ordinance, I think you have to, this does not comply with that.
Any further discussion? Would the town manager like to jump in with something?
No, I wanted to.
I think that the issues that Councilor Fritz raises, point toward the need for the future item. We've been dealing with the thumpity-thump-thump of Route 77, I think since 1978, or was it 85? That was what year, Bob? That was 1980 that we've been dealing with the thumps. And, December 1st, MDOT is putting that project out to bid to do the reclamation of that section of Route 77 and then to pave it all the way to South Portland. I think it'd be unfortunate not to recognize this particular policy, the request of Mr. Anastos, as two or three other similar requests have come in over the last 20 years that have been favorably acted upon by the council. Councilor Fritz is right that there is a malfunctioning system, and there is that second test in the ordinance that says that you have to prove that a state variance would be required. I know of at least in one of the other instances when we reviewed this, they had one of those tests done in an area just to show that test would be needed, even though there might have been a better spot in the lot. It's a loophole that anyone can take advantage of. And I think really begs the issue of why we need to look at a lot of these issues and see if there's a new consensus. I would, hope, particularly as I look at our sewer policies, our capacity, our need for revenue, which I know shouldn't be an issue, but yet it is, that, we would have policies that would encourage folks to connect to the sewer, particularly when they're immediately adjacent to other areas. And I know the comprehensive plan was done in sync with the sewer policy. There are other provisions in the comprehensive plan as well that, that comment upon the environment, the need to protect wetlands, and some of these other issues, as Mr. Anastos was pointing out in his presentation, that ought to carry some weight as well.
Councilor Carson.
Could I maybe ask for a review here? We're talking about extending the sewer for the Fisher House, which sits on 7 to 8 acres of land. So we're not just extending the sewer to repair a system that is broken. We're also providing the sewer capacity for two other houses that could be built on 2-acre lots in that. Is that what we're saying?
No. There's three lots that are immediately shown that do not, in addition to the Fisher lot. The Fisher lot is 7.5 acres, but we also have these other two lots owned by two other parties.
No, actually, that wasn't my understanding, Mike, and yeah. Bob's here. As I understand it, Bob, I was asked if the land could ever handle any more sewerage or whatever, to take care of it now as we're coming across the street, do it all at once, obviously, instead of digging the road up again. As I looked at the 7.5 acres, I thought the most it could do, especially after talking to Dick Sweet, was two other lots. And so Councilor Carson's right in that respect. That's what I was talking about.
Where I was going with this is we're also bringing in the Hewitt lot and the Aceto lot as two additional lots, both of which now have homes. Even though they're not currently requesting sewer, this would also, when their systems fail, it makes sense as long as you're bringing the sewer across the road to include them in the sewer service there as well at the same time.
I understand that. I think if we bring the sewer...
That's my point about being three homes.
Aceto and Hewitt should be able to hitch up if they want to. But we're providing for Aceto and Hewitt to hitch up, we're providing for the Fisher House to hitch up, and we're providing for two other potential building lots that might come down the road out of the 7 acres.
Right. Most of that 7 acres, just so you know, the majority of it is restricted by that 250-foot setback, and then there's other wetlands on the remaining part, which actually I could pass out something that would show you that even more than the plan I believe I sent you. I will.
But if this is really for only one lot, then that's a very expensive solution.
That's a good point, Councillor. I could absolutely do this cheaper by probably putting in another septic system, but to me it just is, I just can't see putting a septic system in when the sewer is right there. I guess that's just the way I feel about it. And as far as the other two, that really doesn't cost anything because I'm not doing that. I'm just bringing it over for this house with a T there in case that ever happens.
Mr. Nastas, I have a question for you.
Sure.
Two of my neighbors now have these huge burial mounds in their yards. One of them had to take out the swimming pool because the septic tank failed.
Right.
Would that one actually be one of those raised mounds also if you had to put septic, or would it be one that you could hide in the ground somewhere?
I suspect I could hide it somewhere, but I really, to answer your question, I honestly don't know the truth. I mean, as you're seeing that plan, there are two spots that Dick Sweet found I could put a septic system in. Besides the 250-foot area, it's another wetlands that comes in from the back, and some on the side. I just don't know how to. I mean, I have no intention of extending sewer or building houses. If you could put a restriction on three houses, I don't know. That I'll do. I just don't have, and even that, I'm just painting the house, fixing it up, and anyway, I think it should have a sewer.
Is anyone prepared to make a motion? Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
I'm sorry, did I cut you off?
No, I'm just trying to figure out, you know.
I'd like, can we use this language at the end of our item number 25? I'd like to move that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in conformance with section 15-1-7, hereby permits an amendment to the sewer service area map to include lots U23-1, U23-5, and U23-5-1. Having found adding these lots includes a property with a malfunctioning septic system, and we also find there's sufficient capacity in the Southern Cape Elizabeth wastewater treatment facility, so I move that we allow this.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Any further discussion?
So do we need some proof that the replacement system needs a variance?
Because that's what our thing says.
I mean, have we had, I mean, I haven't seen any paperwork that this is a failed system, that it would need some variances from the state of Maine.
So you're in doubt that there is a failing system? Is that what you're...
No, but that
it needs to have a sewer in order to, or it would need a variance from the state of Maine in order to design a system that would be acceptable for handling the waste from that house. That's what the ordinance said.
Well, I stand by my motion as I made it.
Ready to...
Anyone else want to...
Move the question.
Move the question? All right. All in favor of the motion as read?
I didn't get to speak.
All opposed? Show it to be 6-1, Councilor Fritz. Thank you.
I think it's wrong.
Item number 26-02-03, requests from the town manager to further review issues relating to sewer extensions. Mr. McGovern.
The key words in my memo to you, I think it's time to see if there is a new community consensus on policies relating to when new neighborhoods and existing homes should be on septic systems or permitted to connect to sewers. And, you know, I've drafted some amendments that, you know, are intended to be for discussion purposes that say we ought to look at this issue, but I would recommend that you refer this to the planning board with a recommendation that they report back to you by January 31st.
Would someone like to make that motion?
I make that motion.
As stated by the town manager?
Yeah, that the matter be referred to the planning board for their study and returned to the council with a report by January 31st.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
It's 2003.
Yeah, 2003. We've already had the other one.
Councilor Fritz.
I don't object to looking at the policy again, because I think that could be, but I think it is a lot bigger issue than just sewers. It's a lot of what the comprehensive plan was based on, and it just... The strategy that's recommended in the first section of the comprehensive plan, that there needs to be a mixture of tools to control growth in the town, which people said they wanted at that time. A number of them is clustering, buffering, density incentives and disincentives, impact fees, public acquisition, and policy on sewer connection. It is a strategy. And I just think it's interesting to point out the number of building units, housing units, that the town of Cape Elizabeth had in the 90s. We had 8% growth in Cape Elizabeth, and we had a policy of strict sewer area requirements. The town of Cumberland grew 24%. The town of Falmouth grew 26%. The town of Scarborough, 31%. They all had expansive sewer policies to sewer every development that they put in, except maybe on some very large lots. We had a very consistent, anywhere from 20 to 30 housing units built every year in the 90s. Where these other towns had many more. We've just gone through a series of public buildings. If we want to have a lot more expansion of our school, then we should go to a policy of expanding sewers more extensively in this town. And I don't want to build any more buildings. I really think you can look to Falmouth, Cumberland, and Scarborough to see what sewers does and compare it to how Cape Elizabeth has maintained a very steady pace over the 90s. So I will be voting against doing this.
Any further discussion?
I just have one comment. I think it's always, almost always, worthwhile just
re-looking at the issue to see if indeed there is a new community consensus. I mean, times change, people's opinions change, and we may come up with exactly the same thing that we had before, but I think it's worthwhile just whatever we do in the town to look at it periodically. That's been our policy in a whole variety of subjects. That's why we're looking at all the waste policies, the dumps, and all sorts of other things. And I think it's just good policy in general to have. So.
Thank you. Councilor Gossin.
Could I just ask the manager, since we did this the first three terms, I was sitting here, we did this over and over again. Was it the planning board? We had so many subcommittees that worked on this. Is that the appropriate place for them to review it first? Is that the right place for us to send this? I know it says that.
Yeah, it's up to the council. You're correct. In the 1970s, I think we had three or four sewer study committees, sewer facility committees.
Citizens. It was citizens.
Two referendums.
I mean,
that's right.
There's strong feelings about sewer and growth in this town.
So it is, planning board is it? You think we could...
I think it's a good place to start, but it's a good place to start.
Any further discussion? All right, all in favor of sending the proposal to the planning board? All opposed? 6-1, Councilor Fritz. Item number 27-0102, recommendation of the planning board regarding the inclusion of golf course as a permitted use in the RA zone. This particular item was brought forth to bring basically the Papoodic Club, the golf course in town, into some standing, as it is presently. The golf course was omitted from any of the zoning language. A neighbor has brought up some very interesting questions as to what, there was another zone listed, and I don't have it in front of me, the
RB.
The RB, that really do not appear to be addressed very well, and it would be my recommendation, I guess, as well as the manager, that this item be referred back to the planning board to take a look at those issues that have been raised, and then to get that back to us.
That may be your recommendation. My recommendation was to refer to the ordinance.
To the ordinance committee?
You're not speaking for me when you say
I'm sorry.
Send it back.
The ordinance committee works for me as well. It'll save that step. So, but is there any... we do have one neighbor. Mr. Keller, if you'd like to speak, we'll give you a couple of seconds.
My name is Ken Keller. I live at 291 Spurwink Avenue. I'm an immediate abutter to the area that we're talking about. I think when this was proposed initially, the idea was to regularize and so forth the Papoodic Club, which sounds like a good idea. And somebody threw in the land that they've got across the street. Now, probably you may or may not be aware of it, since 1941, the club, to protect its entrance, has owned a two-acre lot almost directly in front of the entrance to the club. A few years ago, they bought the back 28 or 29 acres. Now, this thing goes all the way back to the 4 acres of Sprague and then the land that the town owns. And it also goes along the back lot lines of all the houses on Eastman Road for about 1,500 or 1,800 feet, which I don't think most people are aware of. They think it's just a rectangle that goes straight back. It doesn't. It goes all the way over to Eastman. The word spot zoning was used earlier today. This is not only spot zoning, it's a change of the whole zone. You might as well switch the whole thing to CA because it's golf course. You know, you just make it, you know, that color line just running across the street. You're not really proposing to do this. You're only proposing to change this to an allowed use, a golf course. The only trouble is an allowed use of a golf course, the way a golf course is designed, this could be anything from a hot dog stand to a swimming pool to a parking lot to maintenance structures, almost anything. In other words, anything you see at Papoodic could be across, and which is ostensibly a residential 2-acre zoned area. That is probably not an awfully good idea if you stop to think that if the club were to follow the present rules and regulations, if they wanted to put a parking lot in, they'd have to come in and get a variance. If they wanted to put a swimming pool in, they'd have to come in and get a variance. With this particular one, they can do literally anything that's allowed under the golf course designation, which is pretty much anything that you could imagine being done. Parking lots, swimming pools, putting greens, driving ranges, maintenance structures. I checked with the police department today and found out, as you are probably all aware of, this is one of our high-speed highways, not meant to be, but it tends to be. Has a lot of curves, a lot of hills. People drive too fast. I've got a sign on my driveway that says a hidden drive just before you come to my house. Last year we had 7 accidents between Route 77 and Scott Dyer Road. The year before we had 5, the year before we had 7. This year we've had 8. Last week there was a pretty nifty accident at the entrance to Proputic. One of the members pulling out got front-ended or side-ended or something or other, but the ambulance has carted off at least one person. I didn't go down to take a look. You can imagine a driveway almost opposite the club entrance. Cars coming in from the left, cars coming in from the right, people walking across the street from left to right, from right to left, a swimming pool, about children walking back and forth. All I'm saying is that that particular location is not an ideal location for essentially a commercial operation. I've got nothing against the club there. Good neighbor as far as I'm concerned. Outside of, I don't think that they ought to be allowed to move their zoning into a residential area across a very busy street. A busy street that's getting more and more busy as development takes place out along that area. So my suggestion is that, you know, this be given a little closer attention. That, it sounds awfully easy. Well, it's just extended. They own it on both sides of the, so they might as well be in the same zone, or at least in the same allowable zone. And I'm only saying there's a lot of difference when you have something on two sides of the street. You know, I'm always reminded when you're looking for rural property, buy the property on both sides, because a guy may put a pig farm on the other side. And it sort of applies to here, too. It's fine to have a golf course where it is, but don't extend the golf course all the way to the town-owned land, which is inland about 1,500 or 1,800 feet, and all the way over to Eastman Avenue. That's something else again. And I really think it ought to be given some more thought.
Thank you. Anybody prepared to refer this item to the Ordinance Committee?
I guess I have a question there. It's a question of notice, and did all of the abutting property owners receive notice?
No. No, there were notices sent out for the best efforts of the office that sends out notices, and you know, we know Mr. Keller has indicated he didn't receive a notice. We also checked the list, and he wasn't on the list, so he didn't receive a notice. But you know, there were, you know, most of the notices appeared to have been sent out, and quite frankly, I don't remember if there was another one or not that wasn't when they checked it. But you know, we're not under any legal statutory requirement to be 100% accurate in sending notices. We're simply have to do our best, and unfortunately, as Mr. Keller indicates,
wasn't quite good enough this time.
He didn't know about it when it was at the planning board level, but obviously before the ordinance committee and the council, they've updated their list, and we'll be sure that as this progresses, that everyone's notified.
I guess whether or not there was a legal requirement for notice, to the extent that we try to notice everyone and we didn't, as a practical matter, we have a defect, whether it's legal or not. And I would prefer to see, go back to the planning board to have all of the property owners that are affected have an opportunity before the planning board. It may well be that the same result ensues from that, but let them have another chance at it.
Anyone else? Councilor McGinty.
Yeah, I would agree with
with Mary Ann, sorry.
Lynch.
I'm reading...
What's her name?
I'm reading Mr. Keller's email that I got. I think he raised enough questions in my mind that I think it needs to be looked at further. And based on what Mary Ann said about the noticing perhaps being not as well as it could have been, we'll be sending it back to Planning Board for further review.
Councilor Carson.
When this first sort of came to my attention, it did not talk about the land across the street, did it? It only talked about straightening out the wordage about the existing golf course. Mm. So the addition of the land across the street, when did that happen?
That land is separate law.
I mean, did that come...
As the town manager...
This has already been to the Planning Board, right?
Correct.
Planning Board has reviewed this and has unanimously recommended it to them.
But did they, during...
They were aware it was both sides of the road, yes.
Oh, they did? They were? But we?
Sorry.
Councilor Swift-Chiara, would you like to add something?
I'm sorry. I'm just a little hot here, and so I'm not observing proper procedure. I apologize. The notice that went out to the people, and I understand Mr. Keller got omitted inadvertently, but notice that did go out for the Planning Board meeting, was it clear in that notice, do you know, Mr. Manager, did it talk about the Purputic Club? I'm wondering if the reason that there was very little response to the Planning Board was that people were thinking about the existing golf course, and I certainly had no idea Purputic owned this big chunk of land across the street, and so I'm wondering if everybody who got the notice was just thinking, oh, that's the club.
That question was directed at me, and I don't know what they might have been thinking.
No, my question was the wording, did the wording make explicit
I don't know.
The property across the street? Well, I agree with Councilor Lynch, and I do think that if there is notice, as there should be, sent to abutters, that we try to be clear in the notice that they understand that they're being notified because they're in a butter to the property across the street.
That's fine, and I understand that, but I wouldn't want this to be considered a precedent that whenever there's a single error of a notice not going out, that it's automatically going to go back. And, you know, I can hear this, you know, example cited in the future as, you know, on August, whatever the day is, 12, 2002, it was discovered a notice hadn't been sent by the Planning Board to someone, and you all see where I'm going with that.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to clarify, the reason I'm interested in seeing this go back to the Planning Board is not because Mr. Keller wasn't noticed, although that was indeed unfortunate. That's not the reason. The reason is I think he brings up some interesting questions that I was certainly unaware of, and I have a feeling many people were unaware of. If he had gotten the notice and it brought up the very same issues, I'd still be thinking we should go back to the Planning Board.
All right. Councilor Fritz, are you still a member of the club?
I am, yes, but I actually don't know what they're intending to do. I haven't paid enough attention. I guess I don't know whether it's proper to ask the Purputic Club what their intentions are before changes are made in the zoning ordinance. I mean, I am concerned, since I do go in and out of that driveway, I'm very concerned about the site distance there. And for something to happen on the other side of the road, where you'd have back and forth, I think that's a significant issue.
Councilor Barry.
I share all those concerns, but I don't think it's what they intend to do. It's what they have a right to do.
Yes.
We're concerned about where policymakers
have
a right. And I think that they...
Councilor Carson.
Could we be sure, I think, and listening to Mr. Keller, I'm quite familiar with all those roads, but I sure would like to see what that piece of land looks like, because it goes back to our protected piece there on Sawyer Road, I think. The little antique cape that was just sold. Yeah.
The Davis property.
Right.
The Davis was, he bought 60 acres, this is 30 acres of the 60 acres.
Right.
Okay, that, the spray of land, 4 acres, little narrow thing about this wide, goes all the way across both of them. And then beyond the spray of land, which looks like it must be 200 feet wide, is a bigger thing on the map of Purple's townhouse that goes to Sawyer, that goes to Eastman, and so forth.
Well, we'll get a map. I just would like a map.
All right. Is it, Councilor Fritz.
The manager has just informed me that because I am a stockholder of Caputic, that I should abstain from discussion of this. So I think I will abstain from that.
Okay, I think we need a motion to excuse Councilor Fritz.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor of excusing Councilor Fritz? It's unanimous. Thank you, Carol. Sorry about that. I just have to think about it. Is anyone prepared to make a motion then to send it either to the Planning Board or to the Ordinance Committee?
Well, I would move that we send this issue back to the Planning Board and just ask them to take a look at it again in light of the concerns raised and the lack of notice given to Mr. Keller last month.
Can we not, maybe not put in both the notice, because we do really don't want to keep that as part of a motion or part of a record, I don't think. It should be more based on the issues rather than a notice was not given to one party. If you want to keep
I guess
it there.
I'll take that as a friendly amendment. I don't see this particularly precedent-setting, that the Caputic Club is a very large landowner. And so, frankly, I think that it is different than many other instances. And generally, I guess I would err on the side of giving a butter's notice, even if it means a delay of a month. But I'll take it as a friendly
But if you want to leave it as is, that's fine.
I think it's still quite golf.
Is there a second, Councilor?
I second it.
All right. We'll leave it as is. Any further discussion? Mr. Manager?
Yeah. While we're disclosing issues, I do want to make another disclosure. Every year, the town has a golf tournament at the Caputic Club. The club makes its course available for that tournament. This year, it's scheduled for the Tuesday after Labor Day. The Caputic Club does not charge the town for the use of the course. On that day, it's for volunteers and for certain employees. I just wanted to make that disclosure, as we typically do after the tournament and announce it at the following council meeting, but under this circumstance, I thought it appropriate to answer to let it be known this evening.
Probably not a bad idea. All in favor of the motion to refer to the Planning Board? It ought to be 6-0. Councilor Fritz excused. Thank you, Mr. Keller. Item number 28-02-03, recommendation from the Conservation Commission recommending a master plan for the Gullcrest Trails. This item was debated by the Conservation Commission. There is a very nice, for the public, the report that they have made. The council had indicated earlier that they wish to meet with the Conservation Commission to go over this. It would be my recommendation that we just vote to accept the report and then meet with the Conservation Commission to go over it in detail at a later date. Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
Yes, I would move that we have a workshop with the council have a workshop with the Conservation Commission, and I believe that a date of October 7th has been mentioned as a potential date.
And to accept the
I also move that we accept or receive the report.
Very good. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I'll bring this up at the workshop, but this fails to note that the community garden is in existence there, and it has trails and a kiosk right in the center of the community garden.
You may want to mention that to them later then.
I will at the...
I bet you will.
I'm glad you brought that to our attention.
Yeah. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion? So to be unanimous. Item number 29-02-03, a recommendation for the trustees of the Thomas Memorial Library for a new policy for displays and exhibits. The trustees have brought forward a recommendation. Actually, I believe the council had recommended they take a look at it to see if they vendors, particularly display folks that are displaying at the library be given the opportunity to sell their wares or their art from the library. Councilor Swift-Kayata.
I move that we accept and approve the trustees' new displays and exhibits policy to allow for the sale of artwork and the assessment of the commission for such sales.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I'd just like to say I think this is a real improvement over what the policy had previously been, because we had, I think the artwork and the exhibits at the library really add to the culture of the town and the enjoyment of going to the library, and I was fairly disturbed when we said they couldn't be there and couldn't give the prices of things. So I think I'm very much in favor.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion to accept the recommendation of the trustees of the Memorial Library? Show it to be unanimous. Item number 30-0203, recommendation from the town manager regarding a proposed agreement with ASCAP. Mr. McGovern, would you be interested in explaining yourself?
Yeah, it's extortion.
Yeah.
It's the enemy of musicians.
We've received a couple of opinions from attorneys, both from the Maine Municipal Association and ourselves, that this is an issue we should consider. You know, I've heard, you know, some discussion that this is difficult. It's, you know, $250, I believe, is the amount. However, you know, I think it's important for the town as a corporate entity to respect copyright laws. And, you know, even though we may not be happy with this particular request, it is something that I think we have a responsibility to do as we, you know, deal with this particular issue. I'll leave it at that. I could go into more discussion, but I don't want to put undue pressure on the council if you decide that it's something you'd prefer not to do.
Councilor Swift-Kayata.
I think it's a pain, but I also think it's the right thing to do. I think it's the law, and I would hate to be in the position of voting to flout the law, so I'd like to move that we authorize the manager to sign this agreement with ASCAP.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Councilor Berry.
What is our exposure if we do not enter a contract?
Mr. McGovern, do you know?
Mr. Berry, as you know, I'm not an attorney and not an expert, nor am I insurance and an expert on exposures. Let me answer it a different way, if I might, with your permission. We do have music at a number of municipal events, everything from graduations mm-hmm. to Family Fun Day to Memorial Day. You know, even I remember we had for the 100th anniversary of the town hall, we had a local musician who brought in an organ and played a couple of songs.
Anybody we know?
We also, he was great. We also have...
You know, he violated the law, though. That's
through community services, we have events for senior citizens.
They don't like
We have music, you know, at some of the activities over there. We also play music on our CETV station as background music, even though we import it from someone else. That's where we get it.
But that's not live, right?
It's no, that's canned. The live performances would be everything from recitations at Memorial Day through songs performed at Memorial Day through some of the things at Family Fun Day, graduation, and you know, I know we're doing a senior citizen event coming up pretty quick, and I just agreed to a small amount for some musical entertainment.
This deals only with live performance, right?
No. CDs and radio, and I mean,
you have to do it on the radio and the TV and everything?
Yeah.
I believe it covers the recorded music, say, at aerobics classes, and fitness programs. And
what about
the center?
It's regarding municipal use of copyrighted music. It says live performances or tapes or CDs. So it's my understanding that it covers all, both live and recorded music.
It's also radio and television. But these
Councilor
people,
Fritz.
These people don't represent all musicians. So this is only a group of some musicians.
they don't represent any musicians. The musicians fight with these people. These are composers, authors, and publishers.
Yes, this is the group of people who wrote the music. They've copyrighted the music.
Right.
It's the people who've
but
written.
It's still a group of, a limited group of people. There may be, I mean, this, our material said, it could be other people. Other organizations are waiting in the wings to come and assess a fee on us as well.
Councilor Swift-Kiata?
Wait a minute, she's not...
Oh, sorry.
I mean, what, it could go up to $300 next year from this organization to $2,000 the next year. I mean, where's the end of this? I think this is ridiculous.
I agree. It's a pain in the butt, and it's nothing we budgeted for, but I will not be voting for the town to purposely flout United States laws.
Councilor.
I'm sorry. I think we swore an oath to uphold the laws of the state and the nation. So.
Councilor McGinty.
I think the town manager's time can be better spent than chasing around this form he's going to have to fill out every time the kids or at the middle school sing some song. He's got to fill out this form.
I know it's a real pain.
Councilor Lynch.
I don't support flouting the law at all, and I agree with everything you said, Councilor Kayada, except, well, I really tried to think about what this applied to. And I recall on the school events that I've been involved in, the music teachers have been very good, very conscientious about doing what they need to do to observe copyright laws, as have the theater teachers. The fitness center plays the radio. We hire musicians that work at the Family Fun Day, and those musicians are responsible for what they do, not the town. So I view this as somewhat of an attempt by this organization to see how much money they can get from towns, because they've thrown a lot of paper in front of us. But I truly don't think that we're violating the law, as I thought about the circumstances in which this town plays music. And so I will not be supporting this, even though the amount of money at stake probably isn't worth debating at 9:30 at night. But the principle is, I guess, and so but it's not because I am in any way thinking we're flouting the law, but as I thought of it, I could not really think of an instance where we were, and so I look at it as one group's attempt at easy money. And there's no easy money in this town. People work hard to pay their taxes.
I must note that I agree with you that this is an attempt for them to make easy money, unfortunately.
Councilor Carson.
Right side of the wall.
I can only tell you from experience that, and this comes from MMA, right? It's not like they haven't looked at this thing. This is just, for ASCAP, coming after the municipalities, just a new organization that they're coming after. But I can tell you that in all of my, in 25 years of working in downtown organizations, of which we've supplied an enormous amount of music in every park, everywhere going on in downtown Portland, the bottom line is, we have to pay ASCAP. And we have tried to get out of it. We've hired lawyers. We've done everything. The law is the law. We end up having to pay it. Now, what happens is, if they don't ever notify you, nobody ever says anything. God knows you're not going to call them up and say, oh, by the way, ASCAP, I'm playing music. But once you're notified, they just keep coming after you. And for them to notify municipalities, they've just found a new source of money by going after municipalities. But I tend to agree with Swift Councilor Kayada. Why don't you get with one name? Wouldn't that be easier?
Easy.
So, I mean, once you've been notified, you know, you're that's it. You're on it.
You're stuck.
How about BMI?
Councilor Barry.
Familiar with BMI, Broadcast Music Incorporated? Any of those? I'm still not clear on what is our exposure if we don't enter the contract.
Let's have a motion and vote one way or the other, and we can... Oh, do we have a motion?
We have a motion, and it's...
Already?
I seconded it, I think. Somebody seconded
it. Was to authorize the town manager to sign?
Somebody seconded it.
I seconded it.
All right. All in favor of the motion to authorize the town manager to sign this agreement?
Nope, we lose.
All opposed?
Good.
We're on the side with the white hat.
They'll just come after you in another letter. It can go on for years, though.
Force the issue, then we'll deal with it.
Yeah.
Billions for defense, not 1 cent for tribute.
Item 31-0203, recommendation from the assessor regarding an abatement request for U50-lot 7. And this was a situation where we had someone that had applied, a family that had applied for a permit, James and Suzanne Gannon. They applied for a permit, subsequently did not do the work that they had specified they would be doing, and yet they were being assessed for a number of years for that work. And the tax assessor is recommending that we abate the money for those years.
So moved.
Second.
I have a question.
Any discussion? Councilor Baring.
I notice in the final sentence of the next to last paragraph, he says, as the assessor, I may only grant abatement for an error within 1 year of the commitment of taxes. My question is, are we beyond fiscal year 2000, and are we beyond fiscal year 2001? I don't know.
Only he can grant the abatement. We can grant the abatement beyond the year.
Beyond.
He straightened it out for the taxes for fiscal year 2003, prior to the time of commitment. He granted the abatement for fiscal year 2002. You're being asked to grant the abatement for fiscal years 2001 and 2000.
Thank you.
Anyone else? I'm not sure that I really support it. It seems to me that if when you take out a permit, it's incumbent upon you to notify the town if you don't do that, and then to be stepping backwards and repaying everybody all the time. There's some personal responsibility there, I guess, so I'm not going to vote for it, even though it's a trivial amount of money.
Jeez.
I know, I'm
bad. Tough guy you are. You know, some poor guy forgets to put the bathroom in and he's penalized for it.
I didn't forget to put a bathroom in.
You know.
Jack, I already wrote down yes 7-0. Now I have to scratch that out.
Sorry. Any further discussion?
Move the question.
Move the question. And all in favor?
Yeah.
All opposed?
Hope you forget one time to fix the sink in your house.
Yeah.
Item number 32-02-03, receipt of the assessor's annual valuation report.
A gorgeous thing.
It was, and the thing I liked about it, he actually referred to me as the Honorable Chairman. I don't think I've ever been referred to as the Honorable before, so.
Probably the only time, Jack.
Open down a lot of money. Out of luck. The council receives this each and every year. It's the council appropriation resolve, the municipal tax rate calculation form, the assessor certification, certificate of assessment, the county tax warrant and assessor's return, the municipal valuation return, the valuation analysis report, top 10 principal taxpayers, and miscellaneous information. Matt has done an exceptionally good job putting this together.
Yeah.
Councilor Carson.
I move receipt of the assessor's report.
A second.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion? That one you put down is 7-0, Councilor Swift-Kayata.
When you get past 9:30, these items only take about a minute for each one.
Speed right up here, don't we?
Item number 33-0203, report from the town manager on flag protocol. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the town council had asked for the opportunity to look at flag protocol issues. As this particular item is drafted, it's premised first upon the fact that only the governor or the president of the United States can order flags to fly in a locality at half mast. And under this circumstances, it's proposed that whoever the chief elected official is at any given time, i.e. the council chairman, could ask the governor on behalf of the community to lower the flags throughout our locality or on all our municipal buildings to half staff and could request it for an extended period of time. It further provides in this draft policy that the manager could request, without checking with the chairman or majority of the council, for the day of a funeral of an individual. It does not define which individuals would be eligible. My sense is you rely on the good judgment of your council chairman or your manager, whoever those may be at the time, to deal with these situations. We're trying to write a carte blanche that it happened for, you know, every former counselor. You know, some of them we may wish to do. I'll leave it at that. Anyway, I think this would be workable, but nothing in this policy prohibits anyone else from requesting the governor to take an action. It's just understood that in this instance, on behalf of the municipality, this would be the way that the question and folks would be empowered to do it. And again, the manager can only do it on the day of the funeral, nothing more than that. We're also looking, I know it's getting late, at legislation to further deal with this issue. Fire departments have certain protocols of 30 days of an officer a firefighter who's killed in the line of duty, and then other provisions. Nowhere in any federal or state authority, statutory authority, is that allowed. So there may be a bill going in from fire chiefs, firefighters, and you know, I'm also interested in pursuing one, giving the chief elected official or a majority of a council more rights within a locality so that the governor's office doesn't need to be bothered in each of those instances. I think flag protocol is an issue that, you know, it used to be it went down to the president of the United States, and that was about it. Governor Baxter's dog, and a few others. That's true, but we won't go into that. But over time, community protocols, citizen protocols, citizen issues involving flags have changed, and yet the laws haven't. So there's a need to look at the law, but there's also a need to have a local policy. I think this policy would carry us forward, hopefully, you know, without a need to implement it at any point in the...
Does anyone have any questions of the town manager?
When the council chair or whoever, whatever it was you said, they could call the governor and say, this was a particularly wonderful person in the town of Cape Elizabeth. We want to fly it at half staff for 30 days. The governor says, oh, well, he's a nice guy. Yeah, go ahead. But isn't there some...
You rely on the good judgment of those two individuals.
See, the change is difficult for me to be flying flags at half staff for everybody. When we grew up in the 40s, you know, you had very specific things to fly them for, and that was it. So I'm concerned that we're kind of just opening the door that, you know, if Jack liked him, he gets the flag half staff. Doesn't like him, doesn't get the flag half staff.
Get that right.
You know, so I'm concerned about just sort of opening the door. I think based on the past experience of the last few months, I know we need a flag policy, but this seems kind of open-ended, doesn't it? I mean, it's no dates, no times, no days. Just, if you want it, you get permission, you can do it as long as you want. No end to it.
I guess I would just say that I would probably, myself this year, it'd be somebody else another year, but I would, unless it was something that was clearly somebody held in high esteem in the community, I would want to check with other council members to see if they felt similarly that we should be doing it.
Is there an appropriate time? 5 days? I mean, that's
you do
at the time of death through the funeral and then finally it's down, or is it just...
Typically you only do it for about 3 days, but...
I know, but there's no time in our policy. I have the same feeling about the Memorial Rocks, you know. They've been there 15 years. Actually, some of them have been there longer. So is there no end?
Could we put a 3-day in that?
Is there a time? Should we put a time in it?
We could put 3 days in there if you feel that'd be appropriate.
No,
I'm
asking the rest of the council. Should there be a time in there?
Sure.
Sure, 3 days is fine. Yeah. I can't think of anybody who want to put it down for longer than that. But we'd be doing it. The governor would do it if it was somebody like Councilor Lynch.
I have a concern beyond time. Hmm. It just strikes me that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And, I mean, the criteria, I am old enough to say that my sense is that the flag is flown at half-mast when, you know, heroes...
The president and the hero and the, yeah.
People that are really important to our nation die. There are many, many people who do wonderful things for our town. But I wouldn't want to have to implement any criteria on that. And I guess I'm happy with letting the governor and the president decide. And not getting involved locally, because the flag to me is a symbol of national importance and national significance. So I'm troubled by it, but...
But this is just a request of the governor. I mean, doesn't the council chair or the council majority have to make a case to the governor?
The last time we did it, I stated all the criteria that the deputy fire chief, other involvements that he had before. Yeah, I didn't just give him a name and say, we want to lower it for somebody.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I think you have to make that case, and I would assume it's not going to be automatic.
It's not.
Because, you know, Joe was a good guy or something.
As a recommendation from the town, I would think it would be automatically accept our consideration.
So I think it would be automatic, because if I'm sitting up in the governor's office, I got a lot of things to do.
Yeah.
And it's been referred to the general's office.
I'm getting calls from, you know, municipalities all over the state. People say, well, you know, we've got this person who was very important and blah, 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 and here's the case from... I'm not going to have an investigatory committee to discern whether this is a good candidate or not a good candidate. So I think it would just be, okay, if you guys think it's important, it's important. It's sort of that local control issue.
Have other municipalities made adjustments for their municipality on flag protocol, do you think? Is this something we're doing?
I haven't heard of any.
The difficulty is that most places are simply flaunting the law. They raise the flag, they put the flag up and down, however they so choose, and, you know, similar to other agenda items this evening. You know, we're trying to ascertain what the law might be on a number of these issues, and, you know, I think the council has done a good job tonight doing that, and you know, deciding accordingly. In this particular instance, you know, I've had to deal with the issue a number of times, and the reality is, you know, as much as, you know, I tend to be more of the conservative approach, and, you know, on this issue, and, you know, the traditional approach. However, the people get angry if there's been someone prominent who's died, who's particularly affiliated with a particular department of the town, and they don't see the flag go to half-mast. It's an extremely sensitive issue with a lot of individuals. And, you know, I would like to see some policy for us dealing with that expectation in a formal way, and I think this, you know, while this policy could be changed some, I do think we need a policy that addresses what is, again, I think there's a new community consensus out there as to, and I'm on the losing side of it in this instance, as to when the flags ought to be up and down.
Councilor Carson.
It's pretty weird that I'm just getting so excited about this issue, but I it's so easy to take the national position for the national flag, and it's so much more difficult to raise it for John Smith, but everyone says, I never liked that guy. How can we get the flag flying at half staff, you know, in this local community where we don't have any criteria particularly about who gets the flag half staff and who doesn't? We just say, well, we think he was really important, so we think we should do the flag half staff. So we think he was an important person, or she was an important person, is not the criteria, you know. I just can't seem to bring myself to change it from the national level, from the national flag. And I just, because I don't know who's going to get the flag and who isn't going to get the flag lowered.
Well, you're not going to get it.
Yeah, right.
Councilor Swift-Kiata.
I have a question. Do we have a town flag, a municipal flag?
On its way.
Yeah, I sort of remember hearing about it at the... going over on the, can't even talk tonight, flagpole.
We got 20 minutes.
I'm sorry, flagpole over at the police station. And I share, the reason I ask is that I share some of the concerns about using our national symbol for local people, yet I think there is people who have had a local impact but not a national impact. But on the other hand, I think it's important to recognize local people who have made local contributions and maybe important to the local community. And this just came to me, maybe it's an idea if we do something with our municipal flag and we don't have to get into the national flag.
I go for that.
Presuming we have a national
flag. The reality about municipal flag is that they're not going to be flying in any way that's not subservient to the national and state flags.
Well, that is against
those
the law.
Flags take precedent over our flag, and you know we can't. If those have to be at half mast, you can't have your own at full staff. You can't have your own at half mast.
You can't. If the American flag is always at the
they'll
top,
they'll take precedence.
Yeah, but if they're high, if the national
higher,
higher, the national flag had to be
the top
higher,
had to be higher,
and you're leaving it there.
No, they all have to fly together.
They do.
Coordination.
They do.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so much for them.
It was a nice thought, though.
We could
yes.
implement this, and if it becomes a problem, it becomes a major issue.
John, you want to make that motion?
It's the decision of who gets to have their flag at half staff.
You don't trust me.
I mean, just because you think Sony's important, you know, the next person that drops off. You don't think he's important enough. And everyone else said, how come Dickie got it and Mary didn't? I mean, you're just setting yourselves up for criticism. You could agree to just do all of us.
I don't think it's been an issue. I mean, I know where this is all coming from. I know what the situation where this is coming from. But I don't think it's been an issue that I'm... It hasn't.
You know, I didn't feel... I mean, I knew because it was an issue at the time and we didn't know what to do. But the main flag in front of the city... institution here remained in the beginning at least at full staff, and the flags in front of the department went to half staff immediately, and I understood that because I understood their feelings for that. But if you're going to declare that every flag in the town, including the fort and everything, is going to remain at half staff because Mrs. Smith has passed on, I just think that you're really, I mean, what are you going to do about the fort? You're going to say just one flag, two flags, all flags?
It'd be in municipal flags. We'd just list it that way.
So the Fort Williams would be at half staff when Mary Smith passes on.
If you read this policy carefully, what we're really trying to do is create a standard. And the standard is basically the day of the funeral at one locality. If you really read this and read it carefully, that would be the standard. It's only in the most unusual circumstances, and I won't start naming names, that we would do the larger effort, you know, the full.
It says flown at half staff throughout Cape Elizabeth.
Yeah. But generally, it's going to be that second one.
But that's
going
only
to be the practice.
Say that. But that's when the manager or the school superintendent makes that decision. Then it's the one.
Just one day of the funeral.
So you're saying that this next to the last paragraph would not really apply because the town council chairman or the majority of the town council would not be making requests to the governor on a regular basis?
My sense is this is going to be on a very limited, unusual basis.
Who makes the decision that it's okay to fly it for that person and not?
The governor of the state of Maine, based on a request from the municipality coming from the council chairman.
I think her question was who makes the decision as
to make the request.
Who the request is about.
You know, I'm reminded of Putter Stewart's comment, you know it when you see it.
I don't know if we could get a consensus around this, but what if we were to just delete the fourth paragraph?
The next to the last paragraph?
Yes.
So, who would
so taking it away from the council or the council chair,
and
it would only be with the manager.
When the town manager and the school superintendent think it appropriate, then they have the authority to do it on their buildings.
That is fine for municipal or school employees, but when it's people in the community, it really is a political decision, and the manager should not be stuck with that task.
But it would take the politics out of it, actually.
No, it doesn't.
Nobody else is concerned except Mary Ann Lynch and I about the fact that this is a national emblem that we're... Are you?
I have
concerns.
Are you, Henry?
I have concerns. I'm a basic Fox Burn person myself, so if I get hit by a bus, forget the flag. But as far as it's getting late, I think the president and the governor...
Mr. McGovern, perhaps you can answer a question. If we do not have a policy, in accordance with state law, the chairman at any given time could still request the governor
If we do not have a policy, we would have, you know, any department head, any person, you know, deciding at their own, whim.
Whim, yeah.
Thank you, John.
So, but you're talking about the police, the fire, and the public works department, who are the only building, in the library, the only buildings that have...
The library, Fort Williams Park, the transfer station, the schools, the...
So each, a person in each one of those departments could then ask to have the flag flown at half-staff because somebody in their department has passed away.
They still have to ask the governor?
Seems to me they have to ask the town manager, can we do this?
You know something?
Don't they have to ask?
I'm not so, I want to be responsible to the council, but, you know, I knew if I put this on a workshop, we're going to have this discussion, and I knew if I put it on a council agenda, we were going to have this discussion. So, yeah,
Maybe we ought to.
You know, no matter what I say, you're all going to have your opinions as...
Chairman, I have a question. I'm trying to get a handle on how big a problem this is. So my question is addressed to Mr. McGovern. How many complaints over the last 5 years, and I'm not saying you have to have the list somewhere, but I don't have any sense of how many people complain about the flag being at half-mast or not being at half-mast. So over the past 5 years, how many complaints have you heard?
It's on average
in the tens, the hundreds, the thousands?
About one a year.
About
one a year.
Complaint a year.
Or question or concern or, yeah.
Then to me, never mind, I won't say anything.
Councilor Carson.
You know, I think that this certainly was raised in this last few months, okay? There's no question about that. That's what brought us to this. But I think that people, citizens in the community, those few that are still watching this program may know that we're discussing it. But I think it's worth something for the citizens to know that we did discuss it and that it was an important issue to us. And that we, whatever way we decided to go, we went for the following reasons. But I venture to say in a community that is now switched where most of the citizens are older, such as me, and don't have children in the school departments anymore, that there's enough people in this community to say, you know something, this is the national emblem. Mm-hmm. And I think that we shouldn't get into this. I mean, if you educate, if you give people the story that we've discussed it, we've brought it up, we've gone back and forth, and it is difficult that we might have an opinion. I don't want to go out there for an opinion poll, but I just listen, it's only in the last, since September, that the children are even learned to say the Pledge of Allegiance or what the flag means. You know, so maybe they won't have an opinion, but...
John, do you want to...
I think we have to have a policy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're obviously not agreeing on what it might be at this point, but I think we have to have something in place to give direction to the town manager, the chairperson, whoever that might be.
But we never had to have a policy.
That's what brought this whole, you know...
But the magnitude of the problem is that we have one complaint a year. I'm not saying that that makes it insignificant, and there are probably other people who are complaining who just aren't complaining vocally. But to me, it's sort of... You have to think about the magnitude of the problem and then the magnitude of the solution.
I never thought it was a problem. I never knew that we even had one complaint a year. I never heard this issue raised before. You know, in my 7 or 8 years in town council, it's never come up that I'm aware of. It just came up recently, and we didn't have a policy. We didn't have any direction to give, in this case, Jack any direction at all.
We did have a policy. You need to get the presidents of the United States to tell you whether to lower the flag.
Or the governor.
Or the governor. Well, that was the policy.
And that's what this says, essentially.
Right.
The question was who would call the governor, or, you know, whatever.
Under what authority would someone call the governor?
Yeah.
Under what authority would the governor give you permission to lower the flag for a municipal employee or a friend of the community or something like that? I mean, maybe they need to have the policy. If you're gonna insist on having somebody call the governor, maybe he needs to have a policy.
Let me be a little more precise. It's happened with the death of David Pickering.
Mm-hmm.
It happened with the death of Jimmy Murray. It happened with the death of John Civilly. And while there may not be more than one a year, and, you know, thank goodness there's not more than one a year, when it does happen, it is a very significant issue to a great number of people.
I agree.
And, you know, while it may not be often, I think when it does happen, there is a community expectation that there are certain individuals, because of long-time service to the community, that the community should give a mark of respect to. And, you know, that is the way, I think, the expectation has evolved over the years for the lowering of the flag. I believe this policy would help to address that issue. And, you know, all you know, kidding aside, I think individuals who you're charging with this responsibility under this draft policy would show good sense in knowing when to exercise it and when to bring the matter to the governor. So, you know, I agree with Councilor McGinty. I think it's worth giving a try to. And if there remains problems, you know, you can revisit it. But in the meantime, I'd suggest that we move forward with this and see how it works. Thank you.
Thank you. John, would you be willing to make a motion?
Sure. I move we adopt the recommended policy for flags being lowered to half staff.
Do I hear a second? I'll second it. Any further discussion? All in favor? All opposed? 2-5. We have no policy. Perhaps we can get it on a workshop item at some point. Item number 34-02-03, possible action on the annual goals of the town council. I assume I'll read these so the public can hear them as well. In workshop, the town council met, tried to determine what we would like to see happen during the upcoming year. And our goals are as such. Number one, ensure that quality services and programs are maintained with as minimal impact as possible on the property tax rate. Continue quarterly reviews of expenditures and revenues by the Finance Committee. Participate with other communities in communicating to state decision makers the need to increase state school subsidies and to study the state tax system. Communicate to the Cumberland County Commissioners, to state decision makers, and to other cities and towns the need to restrain future growth of the county budget. Review and use as a resource a study which benchmarks the cost of municipal and school services with other communities. And complete the community center building project on time and within budget. Goal number two, increase opportunities for interaction of the town council with boards and commissions. Conduct an annual orientation for all board and commission members. Participate in a workshop for the planning board, including one workshop to review the town center zoning. Participate in a workshop with the Zoning Board of Appeals to review the practical difficulty standard in the zoning ordinance.
Yeah.
Each board and commission shall have at least one meeting attended by a council member. Review volunteer recognition activities. The council chair and the ordinance committee shall meet at least twice this year with the planning board, Zoning Board of Appeals, and Conservation Commission chairs. Review with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission the efforts undertaken to preserve the historic aspects of Fort Williams Park, revisions to the master plan, and parking and fees issues. And goal number three, in cooperation with interested parties and other property owners, develop a master site and landscape plan for the town hall lot and adjoining lots. Number four, review and begin implementation of the master plan for the Gullcrest open space. Number five, continue to enhance and promote the town's website, including additional opportunities for conducting transactions. Number six, review the effectiveness of CETV's bulletin board and other programming. Number seven, receive and review a report on road safety in Cape Elizabeth that evaluates road widths, shoulders, and sidewalks, all in the context of retaining the town's aesthetic character. Number eight, review the town's relationship with our municipal attorneys and auditors, and receive a report from the town manager on all of the professional services contracted by the town. Number nine, review the town's investment program. And number 10, receive and review a report from the Refuse Materials Handling Committee. So if I could have someone perhaps recommend that we adopt these goals, then we can have a discussion on them.
So moved. Second.
Second. Any discussion? Councilor Berry.
I don't think that item number 8, reviewing the town's relationship with our municipal attorneys and auditors, and receive a report on all of the professional services is broad enough, or is specific enough. At a workshop from which this arose, I specifically asked that we follow up on the issue that was brought up last spring about financial accounts for the town and checking for by the fall. I think we were focusing on September for a request for proposals from the various banks and commercial financial organizations in the greater Portland area. And that is not included in here, and I would like to make sure that it is. And it was only after I started the discussion with that that all of the professional services was mentioned at the workshop. And I think that's gotten away from my request that that be included as a goal.
Okay. We've had this. This has been a motion, so that would have to be a motion to amend.
I would like to move to amend goal number 8 to review the town's relationship with the financial institutions, including requests for proposal to serve the town, to be reported back by the manager to the council no later than the end of September.
Is there a second? Councilor Carson, you had a question. No question.
I'm not sure what...
I'm not getting it.
You could clarify that. What's he asking? Is he asking for us to put out an RFP for those services?
Yeah.
Can we accept the report with the exception of number 8? Can we accept the goals and then...
Sure.
...rethink number 8 so we just get the thing moving?
Well, so far there hasn't been a second,
motion
to amend the motion. So I haven't heard a second yet.
Is there anyone prepared to second?
Is that considered a professional contract that we have?
It's not clear.
Could that be in that definition?
It's not clear.
I'll defer to ask the town manager to...
I'm not going to debate the council's goals as the council's goals, but I will indicate to the council that it's my intent between now and the end of the calendar year to put our banking services out for competitive review.
All right, thank you. Any further discussion on the goals? Are they acceptable as written by the majority of the council?
We have a motion on the floor.
Which one?
Henry made a motion to amend.
But it wasn't seconded, was it?
But it wasn't seconded.
Fails. For kind of seconding the motion.
Motion to amend fails.
You don't need to vote on that, do you?
Go back to the main motion.
So we're back to the main motion.
So we're back to the motion I made.
We haven't made the main motion.
No, I made the main motion.
Oh, did it?
To accept them as presented, and it was seconded.
Accept them as they are on this.
So is there any further discussion on the goals?
Mm-hmm.
Seeing none, all in favor of accepting the goals as written? All opposed? 6-1, Councilor Berry. We're getting there, folks. Does anybody, it's 10 o'clock, do folks want to take a short break or keep on moving? All right. Item number 350203, report from the town manager, proposed revised smoking policy. Michael.
This has been reviewed by three or four different meetings of department heads of our personal advisory committee. Has been reviewed with our Public Works Union in particular, has gone through several drafts. What this does, it proposes an amendment to the personnel code that prohibits smoking in any municipal building, at the entrance of any municipal building, as well as clarifying that employees who smoke are not entitled to any breaks other than all other employees are entitled to. I really appreciate all of the cooperation of all of the employees as and employee groups as we've gone through the review of this issue that is always sensitive with a number of folks.
Do I have a motion to accept the...
I move that we accept the proposed amendment to the personnel code which relates to itself.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. Item 360203, action on the annual ballot for the Maine Municipal Association. This, each year, we have to, there are a slate of offices for the given positions at MMA, and this year, Councilor Swift-Kayata, as you may have noticed, is up for the executive committee members. The council needs to, Mr. McGovern perhaps can help.
Authorize the clerk to cast it on behalf of the council.
And the clerk would vote for the individuals as well?
The recommendation of the nominating committee.
Is the clerk comfortable with that issue?
Yes, she is. Every year.
Nope, so moved.
Do we have a second?
A second.
Okay, any discussion? And you are still in the running, I assume, Councilor Swift-Kayata?
Yes, and just to clarify, I am currently a member of the executive committee. I'm filling out the term of someone who had to resign. And so this would be my first full term, first 3-year term.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. It's been very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Very good. So Deborah will be going to the convention. Well, this is mailed in prior to that. It's mailed in sooner anyway. So we'll be asked to sign this, and Deborah will be given the right to fill this in for us. So. And I don't think I voted on it, did I? All in favor of the ballot, and I'll authorize Deborah to do that. Thank you. Item number 370203, action to clarify the budget for the Riverside Cemetery. And Mr. McGovern has indicated he will explain this one.
I think it's fairly self-explanatory. If you look at the spreadsheet, this is my case in the back of the memo, you know, I put in the wrong formula or something, and the numbers didn't add up, although, you know, I'm not sure why. But anyway, we discovered it when we were posting it into our regular accounting system, and all the line items stay the same. It's just the total that is changing. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I apologize for the error.
Councilor Lynch.
I move amendment to the Riverside Cemetery budget as outlined in the town manager's memo of August 2nd.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor? That's what we like to see. Item number 380203, report from the town manager on the status of the community center project. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, most of the councils were able to tour the building, see it still needs a little bit more finished work, but it has advanced enough so that the community services office has moved there, although we don't encourage the public to go in there for a few more days because it still needs some more work. The good news is with our other projects, this one is trending under budget. The public safety and Gulfcrest projects had a surplus of $462,000, you know, which was a lot of money. This one, not asking for any new money, but am asking that you authorize something to be reinstated using some of the contingency monies that are in this project account, which is to clapboard the whole portion of the building that's the community center, the whole back building. That, when over $1 million was cut out of the budget, was cut out. Now, as we're nearing the end of the project, you know, it's a number of people looked at it and think that it's worth doing it all. And you know, I could have done this within the contingency on my own. However, since when I looked at the list and it was a specific item on the list that the council was given that had been deleted, I didn't feel right reinstating it within the budget, although I usually do that. So I would ask authorization to complete the cedar clapboarding of the community center at a cost of $33,161. That includes the north elevation that faces the IGA, the west elevation faces is in the back end of the building, the high school, and the south elevation, the side of the front barn as it faces the high school driveway.
Thank you. Councilor Berry.
The question, you're going to use, do these have to be painted?
Yes, these would be cedar clapboards that will be painted a gray, very similar to the gray that you see
on the back of the building. The farmhouse in the front will be staying white, essentially staying
as it is. Would it be better to use some permanent composition than cedar that has to be repainted?
This would be consistent with the remainder of the building, that cedar clapboards, that yes, it does need work. It'll need, you know, paint, additional staining, you know, every 5, 6, 7, 8 years.
Say 4 or 5 years. Well, what do we have in the town hall? The vinyl?
This is all cedar clapboard at the back. We ran out of money, and it's still the vinyl siding.
All right. Do I have a motion from anyone to complete the siding on the community center with the funds that are within their budget?
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor of finishing the job? Looks like, anyone opposed?
I'm in favor.
Okay, everyone. I wasn't sure if I had a vote down there.
But you counted.
It would be 7-0. Items number 39-0203 and number 40-0203 are collective bargaining agreements, and we need a motion to go into executive session to discuss those. We will then come out if we agree with the terms and vote on it in public session. So if I could... And then item number 41 basically is a review of potential dates for workshop meetings. We can discuss those when we come back out as well.
Can we take item 41 out of order to the extent that anyone is interested in that?
No. We usually don't debate dates for meetings publicly simply because of people being away. Right. But what we will do is announce... those dates, although we'll announce those dates just as quickly as we can get the word out.
So would somebody be kind enough to move that we go into executive session?
So moved. So moved for the purposes of...
For the purposes of discussion of two collective bargaining agreements.
For public works employees and the police benevolent association.
I'd like to second that, and I have a question. Will we be returning on television to make those votes? No.
No. Okay.
But it's still, when we come back...
It'll be public, but the cameras don't need to wait.
If anyone wants to call us tomorrow, we can let them know.
Okay.
We can also, if anyone really wants to know the details, we can email them the copies of the contracts if they are approved.
All in favor of adjourning to executive session? Anyone opposed? It is unanimous. We're now out of public session. We can go into the air-conditioned office.